We ring these bells to set apart the time and space and call us into worship. We light this candle to remember that Christ is here with us. We welcome you here this morning as we mourn the closing of grace and we celebrate all that grace has meant to us. As we've been preparing for this service, we've been giving careful attention to detail, fans, which music, and so on. We want to get it right, because if we make mistakes, you may not want to come back again next week. It's good to be together and have the chance now to celebrate together. So Lord, we worship you, and we ask, Holy Spirit, that you would be present here, that you would draw us into the presence of the Father as we sing, as we turn our attention and our thoughts to you, Lord. Amen. So please stand as you are able and join us in singing.
Steady.
blessing video. We celebrate the many ministries Grace has had through the years.
When I start to think about all the memories of being at Grace Church, there are too many that would fit on a video of this length. But one that stands out is the day I was there and Nina Larson, in her 70s, maybe 80s, I believe, stood up and said, "I've been coming to this church since before I was born." And thinking about all those years of ministry in that neighborhood and all the things that were done. Blessings on you all as you all seek the next pathway in God's journey.
Grace Covenant Church was a very healing place for me when I first moved to Chicago 14 years ago. I remember its special gifts of music, prayer, and caring for the stranger. All of the people in the Grace community will hold a special place in my heart and in my memory. And as Paul said to the Philippians, every time I think of you, I thank God for you. I have joy in my heart every time I ask God to help you. And I thank God for the joy we share in telling the good news from the very first day.
Just such an important, vital part of my spiritual walk at the time. Mr. Deb was a wonderful mentor, and I was part of a house group that met at the Reeds. That was very important to me and part of my spiritual journey. I'm praying for you, and as one of the pastors at Ravenswood Covenant, your sister church, we're also praying for you all during this time. So it was meaningful to be part of the band for many years, playing alongside so many of you gifted musicians, and having you be an intergenerational band for a diversity
play as well. We're grateful to be able to serve in a variety of other ways, including teaching Sunday school, tutoring children in the community along with our children, being on council, worship planning, in a variety of other ways, and also very appreciative of the community and relationships that we can develop and establish.
The psalmist ends by saying, "For the Lord is good, and his love endures forever. His faithfulness continues through all generations." Our prayer is that all the seeds that have been planted for all of the years of grace may continue and flourish through all generations.
In the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, and we thank you for the discipleship you've done over the years. Our children were both baptized at Grace, and I got to preach my first sermon there.
But during one of the songs, I heard feet coming forward, and sure enough, people were coming forward with a rosebud in their hand and filling one vase with white rosebuds and one vase with red rosebuds. And on the stem of each of these roses was the name of the person who had come to Christ during their time at Grace, or the baby who had been born. I wish you all well. I wish I could be there with you to celebrate. God bless.
We believe God will have something good for the community as well as for all of you who are still a part of the congregation. We'll be finding new church homes in the course of the next few weeks and months.
We're grateful for the way that we were shaped and formed through our time here at Grace Covenant, and in particular the courageous leadership examples that I saw all the way to what I learned from the faith of the children. And we're just grateful for all that we gained and the way you shaped us. So blessings on you as you find a new place.
The ending of Grace Covenant Church closing its doors, yet the ministry continues, and one of the great ways that it continues is through the preponderance of seminary interns that you've had, that you gave real tangible opportunities for us to explore ministry, God's call in our lives. And so my word to you today is that you matter as a church. You matter a great deal to me most of all, you matter to God. And we give thanks for Grace Covenant Church and for the ministry that continues. God bless you.
Teach us to number our days, that we may gain a heart of wisdom. Listen carefully as the children at Grace Church explain how many Christians tell time. This is how we number our days.
Time, time, time. What is time?
Some say time is a life,
with a beginning, a middle, and an end.
Or this could be the beginning, this could be the middle, and this could be the end. I wonder if the beginning could also be an ending.
There, now the beginning is an ending, and the ending is a beginning.
That is how Christians tell time.
The ending is a beginning,
it keeps going.
Here's how it happened. There are three great feasts. They are mysteries.
The feast of the mystery of Christmas.
The feast of the mystery of Easter.
The feast of the mystery of Pentecost.
At these special times, we feast.
But these are mysteries, and it takes time to get ready to enter a mystery. Sometimes you can walk right through a mystery and not even know it's there. So we have 4 weeks to get ready for the mystery of Christmas.
That's Advent.
Now there are 6 weeks to get ready for the mystery of Easter. Easter is an even bigger mystery than Christmas, so it takes longer to get ready.
That's Lent. It's also purple.
Lent is a sad time, a serious time. So we say purple is a sad, serious color.
We remember something sad during Lent. Jesus died.
But the color changes. When the sadness ends, the celebration begins.
When Jesus died, he came back to life.
And things are beginnings. That's Easter. Now, look, Easter is so wonderful you can't keep it just in 1 week. It goes on for 6 more weeks.
Right up to Pentecost.
Ow! That's hot! Pentecost is on fire!
You can't really hold on to it, but we still have it.
Like I said, it's a mystery. Now there are some great and growing times, two of them. This one between Christmas and Lent is called Epiphany.
Uh-huh, that's what it means.
Aha, I see, Epiphany. At Epiphany, the world sees the light. That's why the wise men came from far away. Epiphany starts with them. They saw the light.
The other green Sundays we call common time or ordinary time.
But it comes after Pentecost, so there is nothing ordinary about it.
Okay, this is when Jesus was born, Christmas. But we get ready for Christmas. That's Advent. It's purple. We see the light of Jesus, his words and actions. That's Epiphany. We remember he died. That's Lent. It's purple.
Lent gets us ready for Easter, when he came back to life.
Easter is so wonderful, you can't keep it only in 1 week.
It spills over right up to Pentecost when Jesus gave us his Spirit.
And the Spirit sends the church to tell the story of Jesus and be the story. About how Jesus was born, shined a light, died, rose again, and sent the Spirit. Who sends the church to be the story of Jesus. See, it goes on and on and on. The ending is the beginning, and the beginning is the ending. That is how the church tells time. Time is told in color. Like I said, it's a mystery.
Sometimes you can walk right through a mystery and not even know it's there.
Children to come up now. probably have a lot more fun than you all up here. Come on up, kids. Children are going to hold out their hands like this, as if you're receiving a blessing from God and offering it to the people of God. Just hold your hands out like that. And Lily and Soleil are going to say the first part of the blessing, and I invite you to make a similar gesture and return their blessing with the words, and also with you.
Good morning, Grace.
Good morning.
It is a blessing to be with you today. Thank you so much for being here today to celebrate this amazing community of people through the years. That's primarily what Grace is, but also to gather in this space, which is only one of the buildings that the congregation has worshiped in. My name is Pastor Mandy, and it's been my gift for the last 14 years to lead this congregation. And the scripture lesson for today is from 1 Peter. And just a little reminder, Peter is the rock on which the church was built. Peter writes to the exiles, a scattered people, and Peter actually himself is displaced. He is no longer in Jerusalem, where he was leading the early church, but he is now in prison in Rome. Peter is an exile himself. And so Peter writes in the first of two letters to the church in exile this following word: "You are a chosen people, a royal priesthood, a holy nation. You are God's special possession, that you may declare the praises of him who called you out of darkness and into this wonderful light. Once you were not a people, but now you are a people of God. Once you had not received mercy, but now you have received mercy." Friends, as we say at Grace, this is God's story in history. Amen. The pregnant pause was helpful. Because this is true. It's God's story in history. It's one of the things I love about Scripture. But it's not just this ancient thing that mattered then. It's a living, breathing thing that matters now in our lives today. This moment, I know, is pregnant with meaning. As numerous as the number of people in this space, we've somehow mysteriously encountered the truest moments of life here, of barrenness and of birth, of funerals and baptisms, of brokenness and healing and heartbreak and joy. And in it, in all of that, we have somehow met God. This church has left an indelible mark on each and every one of us. That is why we are here today. And today, we mark its closing. Amazingly deep resource in good and faithful people. We could have kept experimenting. We could have tried to raise funds to fix the building. We could have doubled down and anteed up in order to survive. But fighting to survive is not the Jesus way. Fighting to survive is not the Jesus way. In fact, Jesus says that he doesn't just want his church merely to survive, but he came that we might have life and have it abundantly. The church is called to thrive, not survive. As our leaders considered our mission statement of being an intentional gathering of unfinished people who are seeking and sharing Jesus' love, that transforming love, we came to a moment where we realized that in closing our church, our resources, our presence, and our gifts and our talents could actually be unleashed for kingdom purposes yet to be seen beyond our wildest dreams. This today, friends, is an unleashing, an unleashing. But to get there, we have to experience death first. To experience missional resurrection, if you will, we have to die. We had to sacrifice this sanctuary up above, the congregation and relationships that we've invested in, the ministries that we designed and started and maintained. We had to do that hard work in order to make space for the new work of God. Because friends, God is at work making all things new. That's the business that he's in. Even you and me. This is good news. So the members of this congregation made a bold decision of faith. That's what it was. Together they decided that they were going to trust what they know to be true about Christ. And we had to go the way of the cross. And now, my friends, from here, we await resurrection. So many people, well, we've been joking about this in staff, said we were going to get little buttons and say, I don't know, don't ask. Because the question has been, well, what are you going to do now? I don't know. Don't ask. That's living a life of faith, friends. That's embracing that God's got a future for all of us. That he's making a way. And in faith, I'm going to lean into that. And I'm going to trust that God has the next thing, not only for me, but for each and every one of us. I deeply, at my core, believe that one of the greatest formational and pastoral works I have actually done here as your pastor is to help you close. I really do. Because I believe so much in the resurrection, and I believe so much in the amazing goodness and faithfulness of each of you, that I'm just waiting for what's going to be unleashed in and through you. I cannot wait to hear from you one day about the ministries you're serving in, and the Bible studies you're leading, and the places that you're worshiping. I can't wait. And so that's what today is. It's an end, and as the kids taught us, it's a beginning. It's an end and a beginning. To those of you who are back visiting us today, we welcome you. And thank you so much for being here as the pastor of the current members, and maybe some of your pastor at one time. I would just like to ask you that when you see our current members, that you would thank them for the radical decision of faith, the boldness in faith that they have made in making this terribly hard decision. Say thank you to them. Say well done. For they are good and faithful servants. They are good and faithful servants. To the current members, thank you. Thank you, thank you, thank you for your presence, for your gifts, for your words of encouragement, for your pushback sometimes when I needed it. Thank you. I love you. That doesn't change. Thank you. I love you. That doesn't change. I love you. Collectively and as individuals, I love you. And I thank you for allowing me and inviting me into your lives. I believe that the trials of this season that we have walked through together will bear beautiful fruit in your lives for the kingdom of God. As you each continue not merely to go to church, but to
be the church.
Thank you, be the church. It's been said that Grace has always had a sending spirit to it, a sending church. You saw that in some of the videos that were shared up there. So many different pastors and people who are now professors and missionaries have come through Grace, seminarians and students and young families sent out from this place in Jesus' name to love and to serve the Lord. Well, today, friends, it's our turn. It is our turn to be sent out to minister in new ways and in new places for such a time as this. And it's a time, right? Whew. For such a time as this. So I leave you with a simple reminder, similar to that which the Apostle Peter shared with his scattered church. Remember that you are chosen by God. You are chosen by God, taken by Him for the high calling of priestly work, each and every one of you. And priestly work is a work of connecting God to people and people to God. The work to which you are called is to connect God to people and people God. And I'm pretty sure it's going to take some really different ways to do that in this such time. You, my friends, are God's instruments. You're His tools. Not a tool, you're His tools. You do the work of the Almighty. You do divine and holy work. And you, my friends, are responsible with telling other people about God's unmerited favor. That's not my job. That's your job. One of the things that I said in this process of closing that made the most people the most mad, and I make people mad over the years, the most people the most mad is that I said, you have heard all of the sermons, church. I still believe that. You know the good news. You believe in resurrection. Live it, share it, tell people about it. It's the light that you have come into out of the darkness. So go and do God's work and tell others about God's unmerited favor. Because you have been marked by that favor. You have been changed by that favor. That unmerited favor, it's known as grace. we've received it time and time again. We've received it in a church by the same beautiful name. So wherever you go, to whomever you are sent, know this. Grace goes with you. Grace goes with you.
Amen.
Because you embody grace. Amen?
Amen.
I'm going to lead us together in a prayer of letting go. And as you all can imagine, it's been a hard season. As I said, we've argued, we've disagreed, all the feels, right? All the feels. And so this is a moment that we're going to take to acknowledge those feels and to grant them and give them over to the Lord. Friends, if you have expressed anger around the closing of this church, or you have held tight to anger within you, with God's guidance,
let our anger go, asking Christ's way and the rule and peace.
If inaction held you back, or apathy has bound you in the closing of this church, with God's guidance,
let our apathy and inaction go, ready to serve in new ministry.
If there is a sense of, oh, what might have been that you have clung to, a reluctance to face the realities of this faith community, with God's guidance,
let all the possibilities grow, ready to grasp fresh possibilities in another faith community.
If there's a clinging to familiar patterns of worship, a clinging to particular sacred space, with God's guidance, you may offer God your feelings, your emotions, your attitudes, your thoughts, your whole self, trusting that God will accept them as he accepts you and will deal with you gracefully. Join me in a minute of silence. Friends, hear this good news. God has heard the depths of your heart and your mind and your spirit this morning. And God's peace, which passes all understanding, will be yours. I invite you to stand together with me as we pray in the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who is in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For yours is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Amen. You may receive. to close is we become what's called a legacy church within our denomination. And after we have blessed ministries that we have supported through the years, and will ministries like food ministries that will step up and fill in the gap where we are leaving a space empty, after that, the funds from whatever happens to our properties and whatever funds come from the sale actually are reinvested back into church planting. Our death is a seed bed for new churches. It's good news, my friends. So I'd like to invite you to watch this brief video. As we become a living legacy church, we Your seeds are scattered for Jesus in new and different ways. I invite the members of the church I've contacted to come up over here to this side, and we are going to hand off to Reverend Dr. Danny Martinez, known to most of us as Pastor Danny, who is our conference superintendent and a guest with us here today, symbols of these values that we can trust will continue in ministry, even as we become a legacy.
We value spiritual engagement. We're conscious that while God is always present, connecting with Him through Jesus Christ and the Holy Spirit brings healing and transformation. So we value our church's interaction directly with Him, whether in worship, learning, service, or anything we do. We value holistic mission. God isn't limited in some vague spiritual sphere, but instead brings about wholeness across the board, spiritual, physical, social, environmental. We value opportunities for grace to participate in all aspects of God's work in the world.
Teamwork. We have an individual responsibility to act, but we believe we can be most effective when we plan and act together. So we value collaboration in perceiving and doing the will of God.
Christian freedom. We follow one Lord Jesus Christ, but we don't march in lockstep. We know that he calls us from various places to various journeys with him. We value the freedom to obediently live Christian lives with authenticity and vulnerability.
Good morning, God's people.
Good morning.
I was invited to read Psalms 119, verse by verse, in Hebrew. But I don't know Hebrew, so I just have to say thank you for that invitation. If you're not impressed by Pastor Mandy, you're not impressed by anybody or anything. If you're not impressed by Grace and their leadership, there's just so many good things. And if there's a level of sadness and pain, that's the right response. However, if there's a level of celebration, knowing that God is bigger than us, that's also the right response. So I want to say thank you. Let me read something. Let me stick to my notes, right? You know, Psalm 119 kind of threw me off, yeah. Romans 8, verse 28 says, "And we know that in all things," can you say that with me? All things, God works. God works. "For the good of those who love him, who have been called according to his purpose." The church being named Grace is so appropriate because in my visits here, which was a few, and in my interacting with Pastor Mandy and the leadership, grace has been a common thread. People have received grace here. People have been loved here. And that is what the Church of Christ is. So we are grateful for that. I'm also grateful that I get to continue to work with Pastor Mandy, not only because I'm the superintendent, but she also happens to be part of the team that holds me accountable, which is our executive board. And I thank you for involvement there. And one of the things that I believe Pastor Mandy was able to see, that our conference has the utmost integrity and that we hold God's people and the mission over all. We care for the mission. Grace has been a school of mission for many. And I see so many faces here of people that have been well-formed. And that video could have been hours and hours long. Alex Sohn and all of these executive ministers, they were part of this team because they cared about the mission. This church was never about being inside. It was always about looking outward and loving their community. Grace's vision will continue because it's not limited to a space. The vision is that people may come to know Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior. That they will be part of a community where they're loved and heard and cared for. The church has chosen to become a legacy church, and what that means is that the proceeds from Grace will go directly to two things, not just church planting, though church planting is a big one. We're going to be planting new churches. We have five people that have been waiting for God's providence to plant churches, and some of them are here today. This is where you say praise God, hallelujah, put on Bible, this is our last service, come on. And by the way, being a church planter is a scary thing. You have to, you know, it takes so much courage to be able to say to a church, okay, we're going to end here so we can go somewhere else. That also takes a lot of courage, my friends. Church planting is not for the faint of heart.
And we're grateful for those that go through a very thorough process in our conference, denomination, so that they can be assessed, trained, and well-equipped to plant the church. And the second one, which you may be aware of, that COVID has not been kind to anyone. We, churches that were not doing well before COVID, are experiencing very, very difficult times. We will be using some of these funds as well to help struggling churches and struggling pastors, because that's what the church is about. We call that vitality, where we help people go beyond their ways. There's always mixed feelings when a church closes, and one of the things that I want to debunk is a lie from the devil himself, which is the church was a failure. You're closing because you didn't do the things that you were supposed to do. If you would have only had a second service, or one in Japanese, I don't know about the Japanese American community. If you only evangelized more, or if you had done this and that and done, you know, this, if you, I want you to know that's a lie from the devil. This is not failure. This is courage. So I want you to hear from me, Grace Covenant Church. You're not a failure. You have been faithful in the small things and in the little things. Now God continues his mission. Pastor Mandy, I hope you hear this even better. You have not failed. You have led courageously in the very difficult things. This is where you say amen. We said, but we're here to celebrate as well. We celebrate God's faithfulness through all this time. Churches have a lifetime. We have two churches that are over 150 years old. But that's it. Not every church gets to be 150 years old. And that's not even an assurance that they will be 151. In Spanish, I love this saying, Ebenecer. What does that mean? Ebenecer in Spanish, what do we say with Ebenecer? Putting you on the spot. Hasta aquí nos ayudó Jehová. You remember. And in English, we don't have the same thing, but it says, Ebenezer, up to this point, the Lord has been there for us. The Lord has been faithful. He has shown up each and every day. There was no service at Grace where God was not present. Yes. The grace of God has brought us this far. So Grace Covenant Church, well done, faithful servants. You are not failures. You have been faithful in the small things, and your Father honors them. Thank you for being a good shepherd, Pastor Mandy. Thank you for being a good church. A church that will be remembered by this community. That is huge. There are people that we used to go and knock doors around and go, oh, there's a church there? That's not the case with Grace Covenant. So Grace Covenant Church and Pastor Mandy, you are released as pastor of Grace Covenant Church and as an Evangelical Covenant Church. You are not released to your own device. You're released to the field, the mission of the Lord Jesus Christ. That as we pray, let your kingdom come and your will be done, your kingdom is here and it's being done. Let me ask you to stand up and we'll pray together. In the middle of our sadness, we say thank you. Because you, as the giver of life, thought enough of us that you would make us a part of this movement we call Grace Covenant. You thought enough of us to bring us a great pastor and a great family. Thank you for Don and Ben. Thank you for their ministries. And thank you for their investment in this church as well that was behind the
curtain, but it was certainly there. You've seen every leader. You have seen every tear and every laugh, every smile and every transformation. Broken people being made whole. People that did not want anything to do with the church, participating members. And now, Father, we entrust every one of these members into your church, preferably the Evangelical Covenant Church. But you are bigger than the Evangelical Covenant Church, and thank you for that. So they're in your hands. That's the best place for each one of them. We thank you that you will provide for our pastors, and that you will protect them and care for them in the middle of all of this. And Father, let no one be caught in a lie of Satan. Everyone here is in your hands. We bless you and we thank you. In the name of Jesus. God's people say,
amen.
Thank you.
As we continue in worship, we have two more songs here at the end. Please respond as you feel led. You can sit in silence and listen. You can stand and sing along. If you want to walk around, feel free to do that. Go up on stage. I know that might feel weird, but it's your last chance to be weird on Sunday, so it's okay. And let's join together.
Oh,
Thank you.
that this group of people and all that they represent have invested in leading us in worshiping Christ. Thank you.
God remains with us.
You are grace, and you will continue to be grace. Go from this place and live as such. Amen.
Amen.
We'll sing this last song for benediction. Only the internet has came in here. We can talk, we can move out, and just feel comfortable in whatever you want.
Lord bless you and keep you. Make his face shine upon you. Be gracious to you. The Lord turn his face toward you and be gracious to you, Lord.